Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. I'm not gonna mince words today, my friends. The tech news is in trouble. Times are lean and the pickings are meager as the once bountiful flow of juicy ripe stories from the tech world has dried and withered, almost as if we're at the midpoint between major product launches and experiencing a natural lull in noteworthy things to talk about. But won't someone think of the tech news? Its very life hangs in the balance, starved as it is for sustenance and succor. I mean, sure, I suppose I could truss up some life support by embellishing some of this week's mediocre offerings, like how Intel's Arc Battlemage GPUs are still being developed. AMD's Zen 5 CPUs are also still in the works. And those NVIDIA RTX 50 series GPUs on the horizon? Well, on the horizon, they still remain. But should I attempt to elevate this drivel with some fancy wordplay, droll commentary, and perhaps a dash of the vaguest fear-mongering? Just to keep the pulse going, you know, limp by for another week. Is it even worth it? You're damn right it is. It's time for tech news.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Tower 300 series cases from Thermaltake, expanding their vertical tower design with a stunning new lineup available in a variety of colors. The larger frame now supports micro ATX motherboards as well as huge GPUs, including the RTX 4090, without compromising airflow thanks to an abundance of filtered ventilation panels. Two CT140 fans come pre-installed, and the right side can house up to 420mm AIO radiators. Finish your build off with a sold separately 3.9-inch LCD panel kit, or even go horizontal with a matching chassis stand for a truly unique look. For more on Thermaltake's The Tower 300 series cases, click the sponsor link in the video description. Before we begin, a word of warning. Tomorrow is April 1st, also known as April Fool's Day, formerly a humorous and lighthearted pseudo-holiday, perhaps with a clever jape or a bit of tomfoolery occurring here and there. But in modern times, the observance of April Fools has devolved into a comedy of errors, as average humans are all too aware of its existence thanks to the internet, while retailers and media outlets treat April 1st like some glorified absurdist circle jerk as they all attempt to shoehorn some half-baked travesty of an idea into a hastily assembled landing page. And this year there will be AI-generated stuff too. What could go wrong? And sure, there might be an actually clever and funny gem or two amidst the general awful that April 1st will bring, but as you start to see early posts go up today, remember that when it comes right down to it, you're being lied to. Which is why I intend to remain loftily above the fray and will not be posting any April Fool's content. Because I just have too much respect for my audience. And not because I realized it was coming too late and couldn't think of anything. And now, on to the real tech news. This week, powered by shipping manifests. That's right, sexy, scandalous shipping manifests that reveal the tantalizing contents of what is being shipped, starting with Intel's next generation Battlemage GPUs. This one was shared by MoMoMo_US on Twitter and lists the Battlemage G21 and Battlemage G10 GPUs, which are expected to debut later this year in discrete video cards that will launch under the second generation Intel Arc lineup. This does appear to validate earlier leaks from Red Gaming Tech that indicate Intel is going with a smaller number better naming scheme, as the BMG G10 will probably be the enthusiast grade GPU with a 225-watt TDP, while the BMG G21 aims for mid-tier performance with a 150-watt TDP. A leaked roadmap shows both SKUs landing optimistically by Q2 2024, but this was made back in Q3 2022, so Intel's plans might have changed in the interim. There are a lot of upgrades coming along with Battlemage, an improved memory subsystem, better ray tracing, integrated machine learning, and more. And Intel will also be able to leverage their improved video drivers right out of the gate. There have been multiple driver updates providing double-digit performance gains for Arc Alchemist GPUs in the past year, and much of that should carry over to the next generation. Early leaks indicate that Battlemage G10 GPUs should compete with NVIDIA's RTX 4070, while G21 GPUs will aim for RTX 4060 level performance. And sure, that's a far cry from an RTX 4090 or even AMD's top tier RX 7900 GPUs, but the entry and mid-range market is where we desperately need more competition. So I, for one, am wishing Intel luck with Battlemage, and I hope they launch soon. Speaking of sexy shipping manifests, AMD has been shipping out some Zen 5 engineering samples as well, it would appear, as was also shared on Twitter by Harukaze5719 and the aforementioned MoMoMo_US. Many of these leaks refer to AMD's mobility APUs, but let's start with the pure desktop versions first. Granite Ridge has been acknowledged for some time, They'll likely debut as Ryzen 8000 or 9000 series desktop processors, and most of us are expecting them to be revealed at Computex in about 2 months. The manifests shared by Momomo specifically refer to Granite Ridge and list two new AMD part numbers, a 6-core and an 8-core with 105 and 170 watt TDPs respectively. Now, a 105 watt 6-core is nothing new, but the current Gen 7000 series tops out at 120 watts for 8-core CPUs with the 7800X3D. So I can't help but wonder what to expect in terms of clock speeds for a 170 watt 8-core with Zen 5, and if AMD might be queuing up another best CPU for gaming to follow up the 7800X3D. On the APU side, things are a bit more confusing due to AMD planning multiple mobility CPU lineups, and these CPU plus IGPU combo units can potentially power laptops and handheld gaming devices, while some variants also find their way into socketed CPUs for use in desktop PCs. The shipping manifests in question show four APUs. Two of them are from the Strix Point lineup, and two of them are from FireRange. And there were also a couple Epic Turin server processors as well, a 128 core and a 32 core. Back to those APUs though. Strix Point 1 will sport up to 12 cores and 24 threads with a mix of Zen 5 and Zen 5C architecture, as well as a default 28 watt TDP. Strix Point 1 based devices are expected in mid-2024. Then there is FireRange, the highest end mobility APUs, which will feature up to 16 cores, Zen 5 architecture, and a default 55 watt TDP, but only two compute units for the iGPU, likely equivalent to what desktop SKUs will include, meaning these are more likely designed for use with a discrete graphics solution or for non-gaming workloads. But the appearance of all these products in shipping manifests means there are probably engineering samples going out to third-party partners so they can test them in new motherboards that are also in development, which bodes well for them launching sooner rather than later. Speaking of things that are taking a long-ass time to launch, NVIDIA's RTX 50 series, and sure, other next-gen GPUs too. Many have speculated about how powerful NVIDIA's Broadwell-based gaming GPUs will be after Jensen revealed many of the details about the AI version of it last week at GTC, but it sounds like we're still, optimistically, at least a half year away from any sort of actual launch, so hard data is still pretty difficult to come by. There was more to be said on the subject of memory though, and the successor to GDDR6, surprisingly named GDDR7, has pretty much been confirmed thanks to supplemental presentations made by Samsung and SK Hynix, also last week at GTC. Both the NVIDIA 50 series and the AMD Radeon RDNA 4 based GPU lineup will almost certainly feature GDDR7 for their higher end SKUs at least, which will increase throughput significantly, going from about 18 to 23 gigabits per second with the fastest GDDR6X to the first wave of GDDR7, which could hit 28 gigabits per second, with 32 gigabits per second and even 40 gigabits per second modules already in the works. We will probably see 2 gigabyte modules in GPUs launching this year, with 3GB GDDR7 modules becoming available in 2025. The only big question remaining is, will NVIDIA pay extra for an X version that only they can use this time around? I hope not. GDDR7 is enough of a mouthful to say repeatedly as is. Speaking of tasty bite-sized things, it's time for tech briefs. AMD's $550 Radeon RX 7900 GRE made its global debut about a month ago, but consumers were a little underwhelmed by its lackluster performance compared to other similar cards on the market like the 7800 XT. But now, you can properly overclock the GRE's VRAM thanks to this week's Adrenaline Driver 24.3.1 update, which Steve from Hardware Unboxed did, bumping memory throughput from 18 gigabits per second to 21.2 gigabits per second, about a 15% increase, and this, combined with a quad clock OC, allowed the GRE to stretch its legs and regularly keep pace with an overclocked 4070 Super. It even beats out the $700 7900 XT and $800 4070 Ti Super in some tests, quite an impressive feat. The only truly baffling thing is why AMD didn't enable memory overclocking for the re-reviews that came out last month, given that the card has been available in China since mid-2023. The handheld PC gaming scene has never had more options available, and if you're trying to stick to a sub-$500 budget on one, you now have another really good choice, the ASUS ROG Ally Ally Non-Extreme, which was originally meh at its $600 MSRP, can now be purchased from Best Buy for $400. That makes it very competitive versus the entry-level Steam Deck options, and provides some spacing between it and the ROG Ally Extreme, which was originally $700, but has also seen a price drop and can now be purchased for $600. You may have heard some EVGA news this week. No, they're not going to make video cards again, but they still do sell things like power supplies, and they've managed to fry at least one Redditor's storage configuration thanks to an RMA snafu. Modular power supply cables should only ever be used with the power supply they ship with, because there is no universal standard for them. EVGA sources power supplies from multiple OEMs, though, who use different standards for PSU pinouts. At some point, EVGA changed the pinout configuration for their GQ power supply lineup, likely because they switched OEMs, but that's a guess on my part. The main point is that they did not make a new product SKU, they just kept using the existing one. So when Redditor Sigirses RMA'd their 1000 watt GQ power supply and returned the unit, but not the cables, the replacement PSU was matched up with the old cables and instantly fried their SATA connected storage drives. Since I've recommended many EVGA power supplies in the past, I wanted to make note of this. If you RMA your power supply, even if it's a pain in the ass, remove the cables too and make sure to only use the ones that ship with the unit you're installing. And it's a black eye for EVGA's public image for sure. I can't imagine how this will affect their GPU sales. To round things out today, did you guys know I could make balloon animals? It was a college job, but I always felt just a little bit guilty about the economics of it. I'm taking a 1 to 3 cent bit of latex, filling it with air, and trading that to a family, typically for a $3 to $5 tip. Somehow I was reminded of that when this story popped up. The world's first AIO with a curved AMOLED screen. The name of this thing is ridiculous enough. It's called the Trix Panorama Exhibition Area, and it features an 8th gen Asetek pump and a 6.5 inch curved AMOLED display. Asetek AIOs, the ones that aren't festooned with LCD screens, typically sell for 150 bucks or so, which is already steep in my opinion. Drop in a curved AMOLED screen though, and suddenly they're worth $300 to $400? To me though, it just seems like they're taking something of minimal substance and filling it with hot air so they can increase the price. Which makes it the perfect closer for today's show. Oh, what, did you guys want something a little bit more complicated than the dog? See what I can do. There. It's a person. I'm a little out of practice, but I think it turned out okay. But there you have it, guys. Tech news for the week. And if you enjoyed my hot air today, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested, and you can check out my store at paulshardware.net for high-quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call, too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.